So first, a summary of yesterday. This was kind of an old wine in a new glass. I described things that are well known and quite beautiful, and they age very well. And the new glass was that I presented this thing using a continuum language, continuum quantum field theory language. And there are really two qualitative lessons that have to be taken away. Kind of you can ask, what did we actually learn? So I think there are two qualitative lessons that we learn. One of them, which is really a theme of most of the talks in this school, is that we have a system with a global symmetry, and insisting on not breaking the global symmetry, in this case it had nothing to do with time reversal, but an ordinary global symmetry, insisting on the global symmetry forced us to have some edge modes. So that was one thing, and you've heard examples of that from almost every speaker in the school, and I gave more examples using this continuum Lagrangian approach. The second lesson, which is also very general, and this is something that I think at least in this lecture hall, I said at least a dozen times, is the significance of global symmetries as opposed to local symmetries. So one thing that you could see yesterday, and you could see that from several different examples that I'll soon mention, is that we added a large gauge symmetry, which has nothing to do with the problem, was completely fictitional. We added more degrees of freedom and gauge symmetry to remove them. And we have seen that in two different contexts. One, we wanted to describe a Zn system, either gauge or global, and we embedded the Zn in a U1. So we pretended the system has a U1 symmetry, and that's kind of wrong because the system we want to describe is only Zn. So we add a great principle to remove the added degrees of freedom. So this idea of adding degrees of freedom in a gauge principle to remove them is extremely common in physics and is one of the arguments that gauge symmetries are not really symmetries. What is symmetries are the global symmetries, not the gauge symmetries. So we saw it once in the bulk. In the bulk, I wanted to describe a Zn system, or even just a Zn gauge system, but I introduced more degrees of freedom, and I turned it into a U1 system. That's much better, because with U1, we know how to write continuum Lagrangians. But there was a gauge principle that removed the additional degrees of freedom, and that's why we ended up with no degrees of freedom. The second place we saw exactly the same phenomenon was on the boundary. We either used fixed boundary conditions, Dirichlet boundary conditions, where the gauge parameter from the bulk was fixed on the boundary, or we introduced these fields, which are referred to as Stueckelberg fields, which sole purpose is to restore the full gauge symmetry. And then, depending on how you look at it, they become the physical degrees of freedom. But the point is, again, the same. We can describe the physics with them or without them. Sometimes it's more convenient to describe the physics using these additional degrees of freedom. So these are the two lessons. And the fact that we had free fields and we could do everything in free field theory, this was kind of a bonus because this is a place where we could do everything very, very explicitly because everything is Gaussian and everything is exactly calculable. So the first part of today's talk will be kind of a bridge between yesterday's talk and today's talk. And originally I did not know whether it would be the last part of yesterday's talk or the beginning of that one because we'll follow the same spirit of these examples that I had yesterday. We call the sequence of examples which get gradually more complicated. But we will see that although the mathematics looks very similar, the physical interpretation is a little bit different. So I'm going to limit myself now to 3+1 dimensions. And I'm going to write an action. And everything will be completely parallel to what we had yesterday, except that everything will be bumped up in dimensions. So the action I'll be studying will be 1 over 2 pi. There's always 1 over 2 pi out front. And then there would be n bdA, I'll soon define the notation, plus pn over 2 b. So what's the cast of characters? B is a 2-form. A is a one form. More precisely, this is a gauge field and this is a gauge field, so they might need transition functions. And this system has a gauge symmetry. It's again, everything is in the continuum. So let's first set P equals 0. So we can have A goes to A plus D lambda 0, and B goes to B plus D lambda 1, where lambda 0 and lambda 1 are 0 form and 1 form, respectively. More precisely, lambda 1 is really a connection, but let's not be so picky. But I know that some people in the audience like to put everything in a fancier math language, so this is it. So this is the first thing we could do, but since the gauge symmetry of A is going to be kind of obvious, the same way gauge fields always transform, and we're not even bothered to write it. So let's erase that and just focus on the other one, because this will be the hero of today's story. And if P is not 0, this term is absent. And this is BDA, very much like the phi DA that we had yesterday in the first example. So this system really ends up being, so let's first analyze this system. We have surface operators, e to the I surface integral of B, and we have line operators, e to the I line integral of A. And they have the standard correlation functions associated with the linking number between, let's call that gamma, so U and V is e to the 2 pi I, oops, is this visible? Yeah, thank you. 2 pi I over N, and then there would be the linking number of gamma and sigma. Is it still visible? If not, it's sigma. It's also sigma if it is visible. So this is easily recognizable as the correlation functions of a Zn gauge theory. So it's very similar to what we had yesterday. The equation of motion of B sets dA to 0, and the periods of A are nth root of unity. This is the hallmark that this is a Zn gauge theory. And alternatively, I can integrate out, look at the equation of motion of A, and it tells me that the surface integral is also a Zn, a nth root of unity. And so this way, we can think of it as a Zn version of the other gauge symmetry. So V can be thought of as a Wilson line. Of Zn gauge theory. And U can be thought of either as a Wilson surface of Zn gauge theory. So let's call that Zn prime, or a defect in a Zn gauge theory. Oops, that's not visible. In this defect in the sense that as a Wilson line wraps around it, it picks up a phase. So this is a continuum description of a Zn gauge theory. For those people in the audience who are familiar with lattice gauge theory, we can discuss this system by putting it on the lattice. We put Zn elements on every link with plaquette interactions that are fully gauge invariant. And then this V is the product of Wilson lines, of these line elements around the circle. But things are a little bit, so this, what I said here is completely analogous to the examples we had yesterday with P equals 0. We had the Zn1 times Zn2 global symmetry, and there was also a gate symmetry. So instead of the global and the gate symmetry, here we have two gate symmetry. One of them is an ordinary gate symmetry for A, and the other is a one-form gate symmetry for B. Yes? Sorry? Should I answer this question, or maybe I shouldn't? Okay, I'll put it differently. He asked an excellent exercise question. Why did I write BDA and not ADB?
So
we'll add the boundary. Wait. So I'm just following the same route as yesterday. First P equals zero, then we turn on B, and then we put in a boundary. So that was the order of the sequence yesterday, and we're going to do the same thing today. So this is a Zn gauge symmetry. So this is standard. Where am I? Something went wrong with my notes. Ah. So let's turn on B. And when we turn on B, so now B is not zero. P is not zero. And what do we need to do? Naively, this is a no-no because the term BB is not invariant under the gauge symmetry for B. But we'll use the same trick we used yesterday. We'll modify the gauge transformations of A. So the gauge transformation will be that B goes to B plus D lambda as before. But with A, we'll add to it an inhomogeneous term, P times lambda. And one thing we see from here is that P should be quantized. And furthermore, this action is actually gauge invariant. To check it, this is very similar to what we did yesterday. In fact, this is nothing but bumping up in dimensions and increasing the number of indices on the forms. And you can easily check that up to a total derivative, this is a gauge symmetry. And we will discuss the surface term later. But even if there's no surface term, we could now ask what if there are non-trivial cycles. And the non-trivial cycles quantize what the values of P. And if we are on a spin manifold, then P is arbitrary, and P is identified with P plus N. So P is an integer. And this is on a spin manifold. Okay, so we have an action. It's gauge invariant, and we follow the same recipe. First write the action, then check that it's gauge invariant, then we write the observables. So we want to write observables for this theory, and all we need to do is respect this gauge symmetry. So the first object we had there was U of sigma. And this is still a good object to write because it's gauge invariant. It might or might not be trivial, but it's gauge invariant at least. The second object we might want to write down is we might attempt to write a line operator. So we could try and write something like this, e to the ia, but that's not gauge invariant. But we can make it gauge invariant if we add to it on some gamma. So we're going to add to it B, sorry, this is an open surface, sigma. So gamma is a line, and it is attached to an open surface sigma, and sigma here is a closed surface. This is nice and gauge invariant. So this is all we could do, basically. And now we can ask ourselves, do these objects have interesting correlation functions? Notice that it's identical to what we did yesterday with the example in two dimensions, in 1 plus 1 dimensions. So gamma is the boundary of sigma. I forgot a P. Thank you. It belongs here. And P is the hero of the story, so we shouldn't forget it. So there was also a question, or was that the only? Who said that? You get points for saying it. Good. Okay, so now the discussion is very similar to yesterday. This thing looks trivial. Why is it trivial? Because it's like a disk. We have a surface of the disk and the line, and in a topological field theory, the disk cannot have non-trivial correlation functions. So this is in danger of being trivial. We'll soon qualify that statement a little bit, as we did yesterday. The second thing we'll learn from here is that if we look at U to the pth power, you see it has P here. And the thing with P here can be opened up with A. So we have a closed surface, but if we have P of them, we can open it up with a tiny A that doesn't change the answer, and then unwrap everything. Therefore, U to the P must be 1. This is very similar to an equation we had yesterday. Also, as was already true there, u to the n is 1 because it's a Zn gauge theory. So we can combine these two equations by saying that the operator u to the power l, and I define l to be the greatest common divisor of p and n, is also 1. That's an ugly way to write it. So if L is 1, namely the greatest common divisor of P and N is 1, there's no interesting U. But if the greatest common divisor is not 1, U satisfies some algebra. So U to the L is 1. So we started with U to the N is 1 as because of this P, the algebra became U to the L is 1. We have another relation. This is very similar to what we had yesterday, and I tried to keep the notation as similar as possible to all the alphabet soup of characters that we had. Now let's examine this object here, this line. Imagine we raise it to a power, so define L like that, and I'm going to define K to be N over L. So let's examine the operator E to the I line integral of A plus I P the surface of B, and let's raise that to the kth power. If we raise that to the kth power, the coefficient in front of B is P times K, which is the same as, which is a multiple of L, and therefore it's trivial. So if we raise that to the kth power, I hope I got it wrong, right? I'm sorry, I wanted to raise that to the lth power. No, I got it right, sorry. Sorry about that. So if we raise that to the kth power, so it's n over L, so K is n over L, and L is the common divisor of P and L, so altogether we have here in the exponent a multiple of n, and a multiple of n makes it trivial. So the coefficient in front of B is such that, so this is sigma, this operator is of the form e to the, so there's all sorts of stuff in the exponent, and here we have I, P, K, surface of B, but this is trivial. Therefore, the operator with K is independent of sigma. This is very similar to something we had yesterday. So therefore, we define another line operator, which I'll add here, of gamma, which is e to the I k contour integral of A, and this doesn't really need a surface. And if you raise it to the lth power, we get 1. So our bottom line is that we have in the bulk, we have lines and surfaces satisfy these relations. So this theory in the bulk is exactly the same as a ZL gauge theory. As if we took N to L and P to 0. Very similar to what we had yesterday, that we have this system that has ZN1 times ZN2, but the bulk looked a lot like it has a much smaller symmetry. Next step, we were instructed to put a boundary. So let's see what happens in the boundary. Because I'm going to argue that this system looks in the bulk exactly like a ZL gauge theory, and there's a special case when L is 1, and there's really nothing in the bulk. This is just a special case of that. But on the boundary, there could still be something interesting. The boundary will reflect the full symmetry of the problem, just as in our example yesterday with an ordinary global symmetry. So how should we deal with the boundary? And we had these two approaches. One is by setting boundary conditions, these Dirichlet boundary conditions on the fields, or adding these Stuckelberg fields. So since it's very similar to yesterday, I'm going to do it again. So with a boundary, I'm going to start with a boundary condition. I'm going to set B to 0 on the boundary. So if I set B to 0 on the boundary, this one-form gauge symmetry lambda with the parameter lambda is restricted on the boundary. It's not an arbitrary function because we have to preserve the boundary conditions. So the gauge group is restricted on the boundary, and therefore we have more operators that we can study. We can have things like U tilde, which would be e to the I integral of sigma of B, where this is our boundary, and this is sigma ending on the boundary. That's gauge invariant. It's gauge invariant because the only problem is on the boundary, but the gauge transformation parameter on the boundary is trivial. Another object we might want to consider is W, which is e to the I line integral of gamma on A on the boundary. That's also gauge invariant. So these are two objects that we certainly can consider. But there's one more interesting object that we can study, and I'll call it V tilde. I'm running out of letters here, gamma. And it will be the same as this U tilde raised to the Lth power. So we've already said that if the coefficient here is L, the surface is trivial. So if I raise that to the Lth power, then the coefficient here is L, there's no dependence on sigma. So despite appearance, this thing depends only on the boundary of gamma. So this is really a line operator. So this is a surface operator in the bulk, which is ends on the line on the boundary. This is only a line on the boundary. And this is a special version of that, which is independent of the choice of surface. So we end up with some lines on the boundary. And I'll just write the answers. If I take this V tilde in, sorry? Well, first of all, I define any U tilde with any coefficient. That's gauge invariant. Originally, it was in the bulk, so it was a closed surface. So then I can put a 1 here. When I stick it on the boundary, I can still consider it. And it's gauge invariant on its own. So this is a line on the boundary with a surface attached to it. But if the coefficient here is L, the surface is not important. And since the surface is not important, this becomes just a line on the boundary. So this is a line on the boundary, depends only on gamma on the boundary. And this V satisfies some relation that are easy to work out just by looking at these equations. So the first thing we can see is raise that to the little p over L and check that this is the same as U. This is the same as the operator W that we defined there to the minus 1. So we can just forget about this W. It is generated by V tilde. In fact, the claim is that V tilde and U tilde generate all we should study. We don't have to study other things. And another object to notice is that the operator V we had in the bulk we had this operator. It has a limit as it goes to the boundary, and it's clearly the same as W to the K, and it's also the same is V tilde to the minus P K over L. So there are many objects here. All of them are integers. Don't pay attention to the details, because first of all, I could have gotten them wrong on the blackboard. And second, they are not significant. The significant thing is that we have some lines along the boundary that are genuine lines. They are independent of any choice of surfaces. They are generated by this guy. This is the generator. We can raise that to various powers. But if we raise that to this particular power, it's really a limit of a line that exists in the bulk that can wander into the boundary. Or conversely, for smaller powers, this line is stuck on the boundary. And for higher power, it can wander to the bulk. And we'll soon see that this has important consequences. In order to examine the consequences, we use the second point of view, which is using Stueckelberg fields. So we want to quantize this system on the boundary. It had a one-form gauge symmetry. So before, we had to add scalars on the boundary. Now we have to add gauge fields on the boundary. So now we are going to add gauge fields, A tilde, on the boundary. Everything with tilde is on the boundary. And it has gauge transformation laws, which are on the next page, A tilde goes to A tilde minus lambda. And I'm going to write a boundary action that fixes the mistake from the bulk. So I'm adding the boundary action. Is this visible? So we have 1 over 2 pi, and I have a minus sign, integral minus np over 2, a tilde dA tilde plus n a tilde dA. And I leave it as an exercise for you to check that the original action was gauge invariant up to a surface term. And so there's a mistake from the bulk in the surface term. But this gauge variation of this boundary term exactly cancels the mistake from the bulk. So to summarize what we have, we take that bulk action, and with this added field on the boundary, this full system is fully gauge invariant. The full system is fully gauge invariant. And we interpreted yesterday as saying that there is an anomaly in the theory on the boundary, and there is an anomaly inflow from the bulk. And this whole thing about the anomaly and the anomaly inflow was a statement about this symmetry of the problem, this gauge symmetry that we had. Everything is the same. We have an anomaly in the bulk. Taking it, there is a surface term in the anomaly. So the anomaly is only flows to the boundary. So we put on the boundary an anomalous theory that exactly cancels that. The only difference between the discussion yesterday and today is that now it's not an ordinary gauge symmetry, but it is this one-form gauge symmetry for B. So now it's straightforward to compute correlation functions, because we'll take any one of these operators. We'll do the same thing we did yesterday. Every one of these operators can be dressed up by A tilde, so such that it's fully gauge invariant. We know how we said before that it was gauge invariant because we froze the gauge parameter on the boundary. So it was trivially gauge invariant. Now we make it also gauge invariant, but somewhat less trivially, by dressing it by an appropriate dependence on A tilde. And once we do that, we have a nice gauge invariant operator. And then we can compute correlation functions using this Chern-Simons theory. So what we see here is that in order to cancel the anomaly from the bulk that comes to the boundary, this surface term, we had to add additional edge modes, these A tildes. And these A tildes have their own Chern-Simons theory. So along the boundary, we have a topological field theory, this U1 Chern-Simons theory, with level n times p. So I'm not going to do it in detail, because I really want to go elsewhere. But I will write the formula. So the object of interest are these V tildes, which I defined here. These are the genuine lines along the boundary. And if I raise that to the S power, and I have another V tilde to the S prime power, this correlation function is e to the 4 pi I. There must be an S and an S prime. This is, again, a free theory. So it's S times S prime. And there is NP in the denominator, because that's the level of the Chern-Simons theory. And there's an L square, because in order to define V tilde, we had to raise things to the Lth power. This is not a correlation function you usually see in the Chern-Simons theory. The reason is that in the Chern-Simons theory, we have just the line integrals of A tilde. So we don't have to go to this V tilde, which is a power of it. Here we have fewer observables than in the Chern-Simons theory. The reason we have fewer observables is this gauge symmetry. So we put a boundary theory, and there was this A tilde, and just a line integral of A tilde is not gauge invariant. We had to raise it to some power. That's why we get this answer. Related to that is the fact that if we look at V tilde, we said that V tilde to this power, so V tilde to the pk over L, can wander to the bulk. We've already said that. This is reflected in this correlation function. Because we have some linking between two lines on the boundary. But one of them can wander to the bulk. So it will move to the bulk, come around, untie itself, and then come back to the boundary. So this correlation function on the boundary must be trivial if I raise V tilde to this power. And you can check that it is. So what we have here is a situation that we have some Chern-Simons theory on the boundary. Not all the lines of the boundary theory are gauge invariant. We have a subset of them. And related to that is the fact that some powers can easily wander to the bulk. So this is very similar to what we had before. We started from a Zn symmetry in the bulk. We added this P. The symmetry was reduced, perhaps to nothing. Now what we have in the bulk is a Zl gauge theory. But the full Zn is still important in the sense that it forces something on the boundary. And what it forces on the boundary is this topological field theory, this U1 Chern-Simons theory on the boundary. But it's a U1 gauge Chern-Simons theory such that some of the operators can wander to the bulk, and therefore they cannot have any non-trivial correlation functions. There was a question?
Why is it that the boundary theory does not have to be topological?
Does not?
Well,
that's an interesting question. You could ask, when do we have a bulk in the boundary and when don't we? And that might depend on some details. If I can get away with just adding a topological field theory on the boundary, that's clearly a correct thing to do. Now, nobody stops me from adding more degrees of freedom living only on the boundary.
From 3 to 2,
you find that there is an edge mode, but I'm not sure there always has to be an edge mode. But in this particular case, we managed to find an answer, a consistent answer, with the gapped boundary. So the boundary is gapped. So let's recapitulate. The bulk is gapped, and the boundary is also gapped. The bulk has either a topological field theory parametrized by L, or if L is 1, there is nothing in the bulk. So a bulk observer can have these lines and surfaces. In the language of condensed matter physics, these lines are quasi-particles. And the surfaces are massive strings that can move around and sweep a surface. So we can take a massive string that moves around and a quasi-particle, and you link them, and you say, aha, there's something very exciting. So that's the bulk observer, what the bulk observer sees. And depending on L, there isn't such a thing in the bulk, but it's still gapped. And there's a topological field theory, et cetera. On the boundary, there are new observables which know of the full N, of the full structure of the system, not only of this smaller value of L, but it's still gapped and it's still topological. So there are quasi-particles on the boundary, there are quasi-particles in the bulk, and they are different. Some of the quasi-particles in the boundary can wander to the bulk. That's trivial because every quasi-particle from the bulk can move to the boundary. What's more interesting are those quasi-particles on the boundary that cannot move to the bulk. So they're kind of stuck on the boundary, but they can have interesting braiding statistics here. So this is a very explicit calculation in a free field theory, and it's manifestly right because you can check all the algebra. Maybe I have some typos on the blackboard, but I think the correct equations are correct. The qualitative picture I'm presenting is correct. And this really begs a question. So what did we do yesterday? The same thing we saw in almost every talk here. There was some global symmetry in the system. And insisting on the global symmetry, that forced us to have some excitations on the boundary. And that statement appeared in almost every single talk in this school. There is some system in the bulk, and it has some symmetry, maybe time reversal, or U1, or Z2, or whatever you. And then there are phases where something non-trivial has to happen on the boundary. We see here the same set of words. We have a system, this one, and it is gapped. There might or might not be lines in the bulk. There might be the bulk topological field theory might or might not be trivial. But something has to appear on the boundary. So only one link is missing. If you look at the two sentences I just said, one about the example yesterday, which was in every other talk in this school, there was some global symmetry that you insist on and it forces you to put something on the boundary. And in this system, everything is very similar. In fact, I tried to use similar notation and similar letters. And the only thing that is missing is the global symmetry. We could only identify the global symmetry here. Everything would be identical to the story that you have heard about everywhere in the school. Is it clear what I just said? So this is a natural point for questions. That's right.
So maybe you're about to answer that right now. It seems like your point, what you're saying is that the edge ones exist because of global symmetry, then you get S boundary from the edge symmetry.
That's right. So what I did here, I had one option with the Dirichlet boundary conditions. The thing with A tilde was just a trick to analyze it. So you could say, yes, I insist on the gauge symmetry, and that gives me this A tilde, and that tells me how to analyze, et cetera, et cetera. I could have done the same analysis without ever mentioning A tilde, just with the Dirichlet boundary conditions. So I could have done that. But there's still the conceptual question. What is the analog of the global symmetry that appeared before and forced me to add these edge modes, either with a gap or without? And what is it in this system? So everything would be a lot more harmonious if we could only find the global symmetry in this system and argue that these boundary conditions are the only boundary conditions that preserve that global symmetry. And then once we are forced to these boundary conditions, we must have the boundary excitations. Then the situation would be completely analogous to what we saw yesterday and to what you saw in almost every talk in this school. So I'm going to present now this global symmetry, and then I'll present just the answer, and then I'll go through examples and show how it appears in various things. Some of them you know, and some of them you might not know. Yes? Can somebody please close the door there? I cannot see anything in the back. Thank you. Well, it's not different to class of boundary conditions. I can still, the only thing I can dial is the value of P. Okay, there are two things I can dial. One is the value of P, and I'll translate that to some anomalies that are being different in the bulk. This will come. And the second thing, I might want to add more stuff on the boundary. Can somebody also close that door? This will really help me. Thank you. So I could add more degrees of freedom living only on the boundary. But what I presented here is kind of the minimum that I need to answer. Well, I think we use the word condensation. This has always been a challenge for me because you guys use condensation different than I do. So the first thing is, what do you mean by, is the symmetry talking about a global symmetry or a gauge symmetry? If it is a gauge symmetry, then the Higgs-Anderson mechanism takes place. The symmetry is Higgs. The low-energy observer couldn't care less about that symmetry. It's just gone forever. Boundary, bulk, it's gone. It's like in a superconductor, the U1 is gone. All there is a Z2. Then there could be a global symmetry. That's much more interesting, because that could have macroscopic consequences. So I'm going to present a global symmetry that all these systems have, and then all I'll have to do is track that global symmetry in the different steps. What happened to it in the bulk, what happened to it on the boundary, if there is condensation, there is no condensation. So that would do that. There was another question here. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I wonder whether here is the same thing.
Well, it's not, in for U1 level Q, it's Q. And in this theory, you could, so naively, it's NP over 2. Naively, it's N times P, because that's the first for this theory. But many of them are not gauge invariant, and some of them can wander to the bulk. So the degeneracy comes from the number of independent V tildes. And the V tilde sum, independent, I mean those that cannot go to the bulk. So I believe it's this number. So there's, if you just say that you don't care about the lines, but the boundary is a torus, so there's time times space, and space itself is, say, a torus, you could ask how many states there are. So that's another way of doing the same counting.
So it looks like PK over L is just P over N. Because K is N over L, so it simplifies.
No, I don't think so.
P over N, you can get that directly P.
Over N?
P over N.
That's possible. L times K. Don't count on the formulas, but I'll be happy to check it again. If
you also imagine in your boundary action, integrate out A tilde.
Yeah, I really don't like, as Witten also emphasized in his talk, it's really, really misleading to integrate out the emergent gauge field in.
Let's just do it quickly to get the number, right?
I think what you say, I'll be happy to check it, but not in real time in front of 200 people. I'm having difficulties doing this kind of arithmetic quietly in my office. It's infinitely more challenging to do it in public. When everything is recorded forever and the director is in the first, is in the front line. It doesn't get much more challenging than that. So after this introduction, I'd like to give the answer, and then we'll go through examples. But I've already spelled it out, the answer. So what we have seen so far are global symmetries. And these global symmetries are symmetries that act on particles in the spectrum. So the spectrum can have particles, and some particles can be charged under the symmetry. So for example, if we don't view electromagnetism as a gauge symmetry, then every electron carries charge 1 under U1 global symmetry. And in many of the examples in this school, the electromagnetism was just kind of a classical background field. The dynamics of this background field was not important. So for all practical purposes, a low-energy observer would just say that U1 is a global symmetry. So this is a symmetry that acts on particles. The other thing a global symmetry can do is act on operators. Gauge symmetry cannot act on operators, because all operators have to be gauge invariant, but global symmetry can. And a global symmetry is allowed to classify the operators. I should really emphasize that the global symmetry might or might not be spontaneously broken. If a global, regardless of whether the symmetry is spontaneously broken, the operators are always classified by the symmetry, because operators are defined at short distance. And at short distance, we don't care whether the symmetry will eventually be spontaneously broken or not. So we define the observables at very short distances, and there they are classified by the symmetry. And then the symmetry might or might not be spontaneously broken. This is a property of the long distance theory. We can change parameters and move from one phase to another. In one of them, the symmetry is unbroken. In the other, the symmetry is broken. And in the unbroken phase, there are particles, and the particles are classified by the symmetry. In the broken phase, the particles are not classified by the symmetry. The other thing I want to say about ordinary symmetries, okay, so what we'll do today is do the same thing, but not for particles, but for strings, for one-dimensional objects. And instead of point operators that are charged under the symmetry, we'll discuss line operators that are charged under the symmetry. And then there's an obvious generalization, not lines, but surfaces. So the excitations could be domain walls, in 3+1 dimensions, and there could be various surface operators that are charged under the symmetry. So just as yesterday we discussed an ordinary global symmetry, today I think I'm going to say that the global hero of this story is a global symmetry that acts on lines, that classifies the lines, and then every single thing that you know about global symmetries can be repeated. So let's first state, what do we know about ordinary global symmetry? An ordinary global symmetry has a charge. What is a charge? A charge means that we act on all of space at a given time, and we perform a transformation. That's what the charge means. This is, the charge acts on all of space. More generally, a charge is an operator U, which exists on a manifold M, and M is codimension 1. So M could be all of space. Yesterday, I discussed also a situation for a global symmetry where M is in codimension one in space, but in all time. In that case, it was a defect. So we can orient M different ways. Either it is all of space, and space can be compact or non-compact, or M could run along time in a codimension one in space, in which case it is a defect. It's a defect that as you cross it, you perform a global symmetry transformation. Example, for people here who like lattice systems, if you have an icing system on the lattice, it has a global Z2 symmetry. Now we can take codimension one manifold. In two dimensions, it's a line in the lattice. In 1 plus 1, it's a line. In 2 plus 1, it's a surface. And we can just flip the sign of the icing interaction on the links crossing the line. So this is what this operation is. It's something very explicit on the lattice, and this is what performs the symmetry. And the main thing about this thing being a symmetry is that we can continuously deform this M, and the answer is topological. This is the statement that this is a global symmetry. If you wish, this is Netter's theorem. Or this is the statement that we act with a charge at one time, it commutes with the Hamiltonian, so if we act at a later time, we still get the same answer. The answer doesn't change as I shift M. It can only shift if that M crosses an insertion of an operator charged under the symmetry. Because that's a statement that the operator is charged under the symmetry. We act with the charge before, then we act with the operator, or first we act with the operator, and then we act with the charge. And a manipulation that is common in the string literature, and maybe Robert will describe later, that we can describe that as M, the manifold M, wrapping the local operator. So the hallmark of an ordinary global symmetry is that there are observables tied to codimension one manifolds, and their correlation functions are topological. Topological in the sense that they do not change under small deformations of the surface. And everything you know about symmetries follows from that. And this thing really covers everything you know about symmetries. So this is the definition, and everything follows from that. So I'm going to generalize that and increase the codimension. So I'm defining a Q-form symmetry. Now this would be dimension Q minus 1. Ordinary symmetry will be the zero-form symmetry. So this would be a Q-form symmetry. And now it's obvious how it works. If for a point, we need something of codimension 1, for a line, we need something of codimension 2. So whenever your set of correlation functions, somebody hands you a quantum field theory, so Robert beautifully describes different presentations of quantum field theory, we could also add to the data, we should add to the data, the lines and the surfaces in the theory. And if you look at the correlation functions of all lines and all surfaces and all that, and you discover that in this list, there is a manifold M and an operator associated with that M, and the correlation functions of that particular observable are topological, it means that there is a global symmetry. And I insist this is a global symmetry, not a gauge symmetry, because a gauge symmetry is kind of a fake. A gauge symmetry is there in order to make the description nicer. This thing has a physical consequence in the spectrum of observables. So instead of going through abstract formulation of that, I'd like to present examples of different flavor. And I have about a dozen examples here. And depending on how much time I have, I present more and more examples. Because I always feel that the way I learn physics is not by the abstract presentation. That's always nice at the end. But for working through examples, and when you're confused, you can always go back to the simpler example and debug the puzzle there. So the first example I'm going to discuss is Maxwell theory. So it's 3 plus 1 dimensional U1 gauge theory. And it has a field strength F. And there are two currents I can consider. Both of them are conserved. DF is 0. And D of star F is 0. And who knows what the name of these equations are? These equations have a name. Good. So these are two equations. See, my questions are easier than that of the speaker yesterday who has. And I claim that this system, Maxwell's system, has two global symmetries because it has two conserved currents, F and star F. And if there is a conserved current, there is a symmetry, except that this is not, you don't usually learn about this current because it's not a vector, it has two indices. And this also has two indices. And we are told that currents have only one index. Actually, the better way of thinking about currents is not that they have one index, but that they have d indices, because we're going to integrate them over a d-dimensional manifold. So this thing.
By d, you mean three.
No, this d is the exterior derivative. I use the same notation, hoping it would not be. D is the space-time dimension. Sorry, d is the space dimension. I'm making an effort to use your terminology. D is the space dimension. And an ordinary current should be thought of as a d form so that it can be integrated over a d manifold. The d manifold is this m. This one wants to be integrated on lines. It's on surfaces. Not on lines. In fact, you've learned that in your electrodynamics. It's very natural to integrate these objects on surfaces. These are called flux. So we can integrate F on a closed surface, or we can integrate 1 over G squared star F on the closed surface. This is known as magnetic flux, and I'll ask a subtle question. What's the name of this one? Electric flux. Right, so this is the magnetic flux, this is the electric flux. It is integrated over a surface. And in fact, we can put another, exponentiate them and consider another object. This is the same as all our u's, e to the I alpha, an integral of f plus I beta. I put the g square, it's not really important, star f. So we have a surface that measures the electric and the magnetic flux. And I can do that in the classical theory. I can do that in the quantum theory. Which actually, it's much more interesting in the quantum theory. It's labeled by two parameters, alpha and beta. And the correlation functions of this object are topological. Let me make that more precise. You could ask, well, what can they depend on? How can they fail to be topological? So in order for them to be slightly more interesting, let's discuss what else we can measure in this theory. We can measure lines. And there are two kinds of lines this theory can have. We can have Wilson lines and the Tuft lines. This is easily written as a line integral of the gauge field, A. This is the Wilson line. The Tuft line is not so easily written in terms of A. I'll write it symbolically as e to the I line integral of A, the magnetic gauge field. It's the dual of H. So W describes the world line of a massive particle. So we are then doing just electrodynamics, but without matter, just Maxwell theory. Maxwell theory, but we have probe particles. They are massive, they are heavy, and we just drag them through the system. And as we take an electric charge and we drag it through the system on a curve, a low energy observer says that there is an insertion of this operator, this Wilson line. And similarly, we can drag a magnetic monopole through the surface. And as we drag a magnetic monopole through the surface, it gives us the Tuft line. The correlation functions of these guys, W and H, are not topological. They depend on all sorts of things, that the distances, et cetera, et cetera. But if we wrap any of these by these, we measure the electric flux. So if we take W, for example, and we put our gadget U, and this is on the manifold M, I call it sigma because it's two-dimensional, and this is some gamma, this thing would measure. So this is the same as W on gamma times a phase, and the phase will be e to the I. Electric charge is beta. Times the linking number, so the linking number of gamma and sigma. This is a very complicated way of saying something very simple. If we take an electric charge and we drag it to the system, how do we know how much electric charge exists in the problem? So let's make it more interesting, put an integer n here. So we raise that to the nth power, and there would be an n here. How do we measure the total electric charge in the line? Well, we wrap it with a sphere, and we measure the electric flux that comes out of it. This is how we measure electric charge. Wrap it with a sphere, and we measure the electric flux. So I would interpret that to mean that we have a one-form global symmetry generated by this symmetry. The charged objects are the Wilson and the atrophed loops. And we measure the charge in the line by wrapping a surface around it. Another way of saying it is that every symmetry generates some transformations on the fields. So if I just do U of alpha, let's set beta to 0, because it's more subtle. What it does, it takes the gauge fields and shifts it by a flat connection. So imagine we shift the gauge field by a flat gauge field. That doesn't change the field strength. If it doesn't change the field strength, it almost doesn't do anything. But imagine we have a non-trivial cycle. Imagine we are on a torus, for example. Then this gauge field might change the holonomy of little a. So this is a global symmetry. We shift a, not by a gauge transformation. If it's by a gauge transformation, it doesn't do anything. Everything is invariant under it. But this is the shift by a flat connection, and therefore it generates a global symmetry. So you have the second hallmark of a global symmetry here, that you have fundamental fields, and you can perform a transformation on the fundamental fields. You have a shift. The Lagrangian doesn't change. The operators transform in some way. And we can use that for all the things that we do ordinarily with global symmetries. I cannot resist. Are there any questions on this example? I don't, because I imagine I have an Atrophed line. If I have an Atrophed line, then if I do that, A is not globally well defined, because I need patches around it. And then when I do this transformation, I can get something non-trivial. And there are other situations. I don't need to be, I can be in RD plus one. I don't need to go to any fancy topology. A lot of the topology, see, you can get into this topological thing either by studying the theory on the non-trivial manifold, or by putting various lines and surfaces. We've seen that before. I was asked how many lines, how many states there are in the boundary theory, like in the question I ask here. So way number one, you just count the number of independent lines. Way number two, put the boundary on some closed manifold and count how many states we have. So it's the same thing. There was another question here? Okay. I'd like to move to another example. Yes. That's correct. That's correct. And the non-trivial cycle can come either because we're not working on Rn or because we define an operator by cutting something out of our manifold. Okay. What would be more appropriate than doing the U1 Chern-Simons theory here? Because that, again, is something that appeared in almost every talk in this school. So we can ask, what's the symmetry of the U1 Chern-Simons theory? So we are in 2 plus 1 dimensions. And the U1 Chern-Simons theory appeared in almost every talk, but still so beautiful that I have to write the action again. So it appeared in various applications, in the quantum Hall effect, in the fractional Hall effect, and k over 4 pi, integral ADA. And it has observables e to the line integral of A, which can be thought of as the world line of a quasi-particle in the fractional quantum Hall effect. So far, I think you've heard that a dozen times, so there's no need to explain that. The only thing I'm going to say is that this system has a global symmetry. What's the global symmetry? Well, let's try and make a transformation in the action. Imagine I shift A goes to A plus 1 over K d lambda. Or maybe I should call that what I called before A0. So I shift A by a flat connection. This is just a change of variables in the action. It's non-trivial. It could be non-trivial, depending on what it wraps. And if it's no, this flat connection, so in Maxwell theory, A0 could have been arbitrary. Any flat connection would be a symmetry. Here, there is this still A outside. In order to be a symmetry of the system, I put a 1 over K here times something which is really a pure gauge. So this A0 has to be pure gauge divided by K. So you can check that this is a symmetry of the action. So the Chern-Simons theory has a 1 over K, one-form symmetry. So we have a symmetry. We ask, what are the U's and what are the V's? What are the charges and what are the charged objects? So here, the same W does double duty. E to the IA is this. And the charge objects are also A. And the fact that the correlation functions are topological, well, that's the claim to fame of this theory. And if you compare this thing with that thing, so just one line going in this direction with another line circling it, or the same configuration without the charge, then they differ by a phase, which is precisely the charge of that line under the ZK symmetry. In fact, many practitioners of conformal field theory and Chern-Simons theories always noticed a ZK symmetry in the problem. The fusion rules have ZK symmetry, and I'm sure you will hear about it from various speakers in, will they? Yeah, so at least two people nod here. You will see that there's a ZK symmetry, which is everywhere. This is the same ZK symmetry that classifies the quasi-particles. You know that the quasi-particles have, say, a third, so one quasi-particle, but three of them are the same as an electron. So there's a Z3 system somewhere there. What is this Z3 system? Well, there's a Z3 global symmetry, and it is a one-form global symmetry. It's a symmetry that acts on lines, not on surfaces. So once I've done that, it's really easy to go back to our example from earlier today and reanalyze it using this new perspective. We started from a ZN gauge theory, which was described as, so now I'm in 3 plus 1. We started from N over 2 pi B dA. So this is a ZN gauge system. It has a ZN gauge symmetry. But in addition, it has two global symmetries. So there's a ZN one-form global symmetry, which shifts A to A plus 1 over N, zeta, where zeta is a pure gauge. And there's a ZN two-form symmetry, which shifts B to B plus 1 over N, say, eta, where eta is, again, a pure gauge. So this is not a pure gauge because it's a 1 over N times a pure gauge. So that's not a pure gauge. But you can check that this is a global symmetry. It doesn't change the action. It doesn't change the action, and that's why it's a symmetry. But it does change the observables, and that's why it's a symmetry. So what's a global symmetry? It's a transformation on the field that does not change the action. That's why it's a symmetry. But it acts on the observables, and that's why it's interesting. This is unlike a local symmetry or a gauge symmetry, which does not act on the action. And that's why some people call it a symmetry. But it also doesn't act on the observables. And therefore, it doesn't lead to these interesting consequences. And this thing has a U and a V. So U is the e to the I, the integral of B. And the V is e to the I, the line integral of A. And for this system, U is e to the I, the line integral of A. And V is e to the I, the surface integral of B. Once we have a global symmetry, we are exactly in the situation we were yesterday with a system with an ordinary global symmetry. So we recall what we had. In example 2, we had a Z2 times Z2 global symmetry. And then we turned on this extra term and showed that the symmetry got all rearranged. But we were just focused on the global symmetry because the global symmetry is intrinsic. Now we can play the same game with this global symmetry. Because once we have a global symmetry, it's independent of how we describe the system. We can write this Lagrangian, we can have an underlying spin system, we can put it on the lattice, we can do it whatever way we want, the global symmetry is still there. The gate symmetries come and go. So now we're going to modify this system. And, oh, I erased it. And we'll do the same thing we said yesterday in the spin system. Namely, we added another term. So we have n over 2 pi BdA plus Pn over 4 pi BB. And the gauge symmetry is, as I said before, B goes to B plus lambda, B goes to B plus D lambda, and A goes to A minus P lambda. That's gauge. So the question is, what happens to these global Zn symmetries? These are global symmetries. Now we added some terms, and something happens to them. So let's recall from the answer. From the answer, we said that the bulk exhibits only ZL gauge symmetry, where L was the greatest common divisor of P and N. And correspondingly, a low-energy observer sees only ZL, and ZL acts on the lines and on the surfaces. But on the boundary, we saw the full symmetry. So I'm going to interpret it to mean just as we discussed yesterday, that in this system, without P, all these Zn symmetries are really spontaneously broken. That's what we said yesterday. The Zn system is spontaneously broken. Now I'm going to say that the Zn system is spontaneously broken to Zk, and the low-energy observer sees only the quotient of Zn divided by ZL. I'm going to say it better soon. But the ZK symmetry is really there on the bound, on the full boundary. And that's why we had this non-trivial term Simon's theory with its one-form symmetry. Another way of saying it is that I said that in the previous example, the symmetry is broken to something. The low-energy observer sees only the quotient, the broken generators. The unbroken symmetry still acts at high energies, but the low-energy observer doesn't see it. But it's often the case that this unbroken symmetry has some anomalies. The anomalies force us to add edge modes. That's why edge modes have to be there in order to saturate the anomaly at short distance. And the interpretation here in this system, and again, I emphasize, this is a free field theory. There's no room for, there's no wiggle room, because it's all very explicit. And the interpretation is that we had a Zn one-form global symmetry. It's spontaneously broken to Zk. The low-energy observer sees only the quotient, the Zl. But the full Zn still has anomalies. And in order to saturate these anomalies, there has to be something on the boundary to saturate that. And indeed, on the boundary, we saw a Chern-Simons theory, which I'll soon show has these anomalies. Well, but we did discuss the global symmetry of the Chern-Simons theory. I'll skip the next example. I have a dozen examples here. And in the remaining time, I'd like to make a few general comments about classification of phases. How much time do I still have? Perfect. So fortunately, so I'm changing topic, but I'll soon tie it together with this one. Yes? No, it's not. A large gauge transformation is a gauge transformation. It's what we can incorrectly call a gauge transformation. It's a gauge transformation that is not single valued. So it's a flat gauge field. So locally it looks like a gauge transformation, but globally it's not because we didn't come in the gauge group, didn't come back to where we started. It's precisely not that. Right, there's a hierarchy. There are local, small gauge transformations, then there's a big gauge transformation, and there are these that are not gauge transformations. If they had been gauge transformations, we would not have discussed them as global symmetries. Everything has to be invariant at the large gauge transformation. The exception is, like there's a theta term, so everything has might transform by phase. But you don't have operators transforming under it. And this thing does transform the operators. You cannot absorb it inside lambda because lambda is a, has 2-power periodicity. And if you put the 1 over k inside lambda, it has the wrong periodicity. So Sondhi gave a beautiful talk. Is he still here? Yep. Where he told us, there was a slide there, which I thought, I should steal that for my talk, except that I'm giving a Blackboard talk. He told us that Landau gave us a classification of phases based on global symmetries. So the system at short distance has a global symmetry, and then that symmetry is either spontaneously broken or not. There's a local order parameter, some operator that transforms under the symmetry, and it has vanishing expectation value in the unbroken phase, and it has a non-trivial expectation value in the broken phase. And therefore, in between, there must be a phase transition. So you guys know condensed matter physics a lot more than I do. I hope I got Landau's story right. And then Sondhi said, that's not enough. We need more. And he had a long list of options of other criteria. One criterion he did not have in the list is something that was introduced by particle physicists in the 70s, primarily by Wilson and Etouft, and said it's not enough to study point-like operators. We should also study lines. And Wilson told us about the Wilson loop, and that's a criterion for confinement. This is a line operator, and as the loop becomes big, its expectation value either decays like the area or like the perimeter, the length of the loop. And these are different phases. In fact, the perimeter can always be renormalized to zero because by absorbing a local counter term on the action. So the Wilson loop either decays like the area or is constant for a large loop. And Etouft was more sophisticated after that, and he added the Etouft line. This is the world line of a Etouft monopole, of a monopole. And again, the line could either have perimeter law or Wilson loop, or perimeter law or area law describing different phases. And that looked a little bit orthogonal to the Landau classification of phases, because Landau said you go after the symmetries, and then the symmetry is either spontaneously broken or not. And Sondhi gave a list. The ground state is not unique. There's something about entanglement and this and that. So I'm going to add something to Sondhi's list, which was not there. But I think this is something that morally really belongs to Landau. Because what did Landau tell us? There is a global symmetry. This is something that is intrinsic and meaningful. And it might or might not be spontaneously broken. We just described a slight generalization of a global symmetry. And therefore, it really begs to append Landau's classification. We say, wait a minute, to discuss global symmetries, don't forget these ones. These are also global symmetries. They might also will or will not be spontaneously broken. And then there will be different phases. Phases that are broken, phases that are not broken. They might be broken to a subgroup, et cetera, et cetera. So what would be the hallmark of an ordinary symmetry when it is spontaneously broken? For an ordinary U1, if it's spontaneously broken, there is a Goldstone boson. The system is gapless. There are gapless excitations. If the symmetry is discrete and it's spontaneously broken, there are different things we could say. There are different ground states. There could be domain walls between different ground states. And in the first lecture, in example number one, I gave you an effective Lagrangian describing the physics of a spontaneously broken Zn system. That's exactly what was example one was. So these are the hallmarks of a broken symmetry. What are the hallmarks of an unbroken symmetry? There's no reason for the ground state to be degenerate. It's a state. But the spectrum of particles is such that it transforms under the symmetry. If there's an unbroken U1, like in an insulator, there are electrons, and we can count how many electrons there are. If there's only a Z2, we can count the particles mod 2 because they can disappear in pairs. So what would be the analogous thing for a global, for this generalized symmetry? So the first thing I'd like to say is what happens when it's continuous and what happens when it is discrete. I'll start with the case when the symmetry is unbroken. If the symmetry is unbroken, for the ordinary symmetry, the hallmark was that there are particles in the spectrum, and the particles can be classified by the symmetry. That's the hallmark of an unbroken symmetry. For a one-form symmetry, the hallmark is that there are strings in the spectrum. There are strings in the spectrum, like the Abrikosov string in superconductor. It's there, it's completely stable, and it's conserved, in that example, mod 2. So that would mean that there's a Z2 global symmetry that counts how many such lines there are. In QCD, there are flux tubes of QCD. The SUN gauge theory is like, almost like in the real world, they're conserved mod N. So that's the hallmark of the symmetry being unbroken. It's much more interesting when the symmetry is broken, because then the low energy observer can see something. For the ordinary symmetry, recall this was a Goldstone boson, or the fact that there are different vacua and domain walls between them. So what would be the analogous thing here? So we can start with the U1 gauge theory, Maxwell theory, and it has a U1 electric and a U1 magnetic one-form symmetry. That's a global symmetry, one-form symmetry. Oh, this is not visible. So I claim that this symmetry is spontaneously broken. In fact, if the symmetry is spontaneously broken, there must be a gapless excitation in the spectrum, right? It's a continuous symmetry. We just follow the dogma. A continuous symmetry is spontaneously broken. There ought to be massless gapless excitations in the spectrum, excitations whose fields transform inhomogeneously under the symmetry. Do we know this guy? Yes, we do. If we look at the expectation value of the energy momentum tensor between a photon with momentum P, everything is called P here, momentum K and polarization zeta, that is K mu zeta nu minus K nu zeta mu e to the ikx. And if you can't see the e to the ikx, I'm just telling you that this is e to the ikx. This is a true matrix element in electrodynamics. The field strength is a non-zero matrix element between a one photon state and the vacuum. This looks a lot like a Goldstone boson. A Goldstone boson is a particle. We put the current here, and we put the vacuum. The operator acts on the vacuum, and it creates the particle. So I interpret the photon as the Goldstone boson of a spontaneously broken U1 one-form symmetry. This is might sound like way, way too complicated, because we already know what the photon is. Why do I need this interpretation? But this interpretation turns out to be useful, as I'll soon show variants of this example. So in this case, the one-form symmetry is spontaneously broken, and the photon is the Goldstone boson. It's gapless, and that's why it exists. Why is there a Goldstone boson? Why is there a massless photon? Because the system, the underlying system, has a one-form symmetry, and the one-form symmetry is spontaneously broken. Yes. Sorry? Ah, there is no theory. This is, whenever I give this talk, somebody asks this question, which is a good one. You can ask, if you have a symmetry that is spontaneously broken, G, continuous symmetry G broken to continuous symmetry H. People often think that for every broken generator, which is the number of generators of G minus the number of generators of H, there is a massless Goldstone boson. The statement I just made is wrong. You can have Goldstone boson doing double duty, being the Goldstone bosons of two separate symmetries. And there are many examples of that, both in condensed matter and in particle physics. The number of Goldstone bosons, what Goldstone's theorem proves is that there must be a Goldstone boson. It doesn't tell you anything about the number of them. This is an excellent question. For an ordinary symmetry, you can always ask, is there an operator at long distance that allows us to lift the Goldstone boson by explicitly breaking? This system is much more robust, and there is no local operator at long distance that allows us to do that. Because the only way to lift the photon is by breaking the U1 gauge symmetry with the Higgs field. It's yes. Yep. Yeah, on codimension one of the volume. It's enough to work on all the spins in so if we are in 2+1 in 3+1 dimensions, you pick a surface, you work on all the spins in that surface. And what it does, it gives you a photon, it gives you a Goldstone boson with a polarization, and the direction of the polarization is correlated with the surface that you picked. The reason the photon from this perspective has spin one, it has a polarization, is because you had to pick a surface to run this argument. So there are many different arguments why there must be Goldstone bosons, and it's really instructive to go through every single one of them and run it here and see how things work. But it's a little bit more subtle when the symmetry is discrete. So this is a case when it's a U1 symmetry that is spontaneously broken. But what about a discrete broken, spontaneously broken, I mean, say Zn one-form symmetry? So if we have a Zn one-form symmetry, it could be spontaneously broken. And how would the low-energy observer describe that? For an ordinary symmetry, the low-energy observer says, if we have a Zn symmetry spontaneously broken, there are n vacua, and there are domain walls between the n vacua. In this case, where did I put it? I lost my notes. In this case, the low energy theory is a Zn gauge symmetry. Gauge theory. Exactly like the one we discussed today, and exactly like the one we discussed till the end of the talk yesterday. Because what does it mean that we have a broken symmetry? It means that we can act on it, and we have to act inhomogeneously on the fields. And that's exactly what we had here. In fact, in the example I started the talk today, it was still here on the blackboard somewhere, the one which had a Zn gauge symmetry, that one has a Zn global one-form symmetry. And I alluded to it before. So the Zn gauge symmetry that we had in 3+1 dimensions is, this gauge theory has a spontaneously broken global Zn symmetry. And the case with the deformation with P is such that that Zn global symmetry was not fully broken. It was only broken to this Zk, and that's why a low energy observer saw only L and saw only Zl. So the low energy observer saw a Zl gauge theory because that was the quotient of the broken and the full group and the unbroken one. But along the boundary, the full Zn had to be realized because, as we discussed, there's this anomaly and anomaly inflow, et cetera, et cetera. So in this case, we had a Zn gauge global symmetry in the bulk, spontaneously broken to a subgroup. The subgroup is realized by that gauge theory at low energies. That's what the low energy observer sees. But the full global symmetry still has a significance along the boundary, as it gave us these edge modes, this topological theory along the boundary. And again, some lines could move to the bulk and some lines could not, et cetera, et cetera. So the situation now, in this case, is identical to the situation for ordinary symmetries. And this whole story with SPT phases and edge modes, et cetera, which uses a global symmetry. So I'll say it again. We have a global symmetry. It might or might not have consequences in the bulk, but it has consequences along the boundary, because this is the global symmetry. It forces us to have something along the boundary. And now we see exactly the same thing for these generalized symmetries. We have a generalized symmetry, Zn, spontaneously broken to Zk. The low energy observer sees only the quotient, so the low energy bulk observer sees only this Zl gauge theory with its lines and surfaces. But along the boundary, the full symmetry comes to life, and it comes to life through these edge excitations, which are this topological theory on the boundary. So that puts the two theories on equal footing. Yes. Yes. Okay, so for the one-form symmetry, as I said, okay. This is an excellent question, and this is exactly the question that was asked here before. For ordinary Goldstone boson, it can become a pseudo-Goldstone boson if we have a small explicit breaking. For these symmetries, there is no notion of small breaking. There is no notion of small breaking. We can add more degrees of freedom and explicitly break it. But it's still the case that at long distance, it's robust, and it's not easy to slightly break it. And this is actually something that was known in the lattice gauge theory literature the consequence was known in a different context, is that the gauge symmetry is robust at low energies. You cannot easily add a relevant operator in and lift it. If you have a photon, you are stuck with it. That's correct. Okay, and you can see an example in the fractional Hall effect. You can see exactly that. Yes. Ah, excellent thing. So this is the argument that it does not work really starts from this reasoning. So you say, how could you lift the photon? So imagine you have a photon. How could we lift it? Oh, we just add a small mass. But that changes the number of degrees of freedom. Right? You started with two polarization, now you have three. Where did the other one come from? It's not there, so you cannot lift it. That's why these gauge symmetries are robust. In order to lift the symmetry, you have to do something at short distance, bring a particle down, and then lift them together. Right? That's what you need to do, and that's a phase transition. It's not a small deformation. That's why the gauge symmetry is robust. That's why if you have gauge symmetry at low energies, it's exact. You cannot slightly break it. The same thing is true for, although the reasoning is a little bit more complicated, for discrete gauge symmetries. Once you have them, there is nothing you could do to lift them. In fact, take these Lagrangians that I wrote down that describe this system and try and find an operator that lifts it. And there isn't any. I have one minute. Good. So it's time for questions. In my discussion, I assumed complete Lorentz invariance, not just rotation invariance. You can make it more sophisticated than having only the lattice symmetries. I haven't thought about that, so. Yes. Well, that was the statement that in order for it to be a symmetry, the answer has to be topological. So as long as you make small deformations of the surface, it shouldn't change the answer. It's a closed surface, and you're allowed to put a dimple here and stretch it a little bit there. As long as you don't cross anything, or you don't tear it or anything, as long as the changes are smooth, then the answer does not change. And that's true regardless of whether the symmetry is spontaneously broken or not. Whether it's broken or not, because this is something that is true, if you wish, configuration by configuration in the functional integral. You can change it, it doesn't make a difference. And so let's take an example. Take the Ising system, you like the lattice. So with your permission, I'll make it Euclidean. So I have a two-dimensional Euclidean lattice with spins. So I'm drawing a line, complicated line, that crosses some links. So here are the sides of my lattice. And for simplicity, I'll be in two dimensions, and they are links. and it keeps going. And now I come with another chalk, and I'm drawing a line like that. And it can keep going. So this line that I drew crosses some links. And I can continue. And now I say, so far I just drew a line, I didn't change anything. Now I take the action, which has some S1.S2 on every link, and I change the sign of the interaction along these lines. So in all these links, I flip the sign. This is the insertion of the surface. This is an observable that I can do. In fact, this is something that I think Kadanoff invented. I'm not an expert in the history. I think Kadanoff studied that. And this is an interesting object in the icing system, where I said draw a line, and I flip the sign of the interaction on these links. And now I can make it a little bit more interesting and deform this line. So I'll deform it to be like this. So I no longer cross this one, but I do cross this one, and that one. And as I do that, I do not change the answer. The correlation functions are independent of this deformation. In order to change the answer, I need to insert something in some operator here so that when I cross it, the deformation is not smooth. So this is identical, and this is what my U is. U is this operator associated with this line. But once you know how to do it in lines, in two dimensions, do it in lines in three dimensions. And that would be a surface, this would be associated with a one-form symmetry. Or put it in any number of, the links you cross in any number of dimensions and any dimension of the surface and so forth. So for an ordinary symmetries, this is an ancient history.
Okay, so why don't we take a break and then come back at 11:15.